Amen. I feel like it's so important for us to never forget days like today, of all the men and women who fought over the years for our freedoms and for the things that we have. If we're able to come into a service like this, we can drive here peacefully. We can come here together, lift our hands in worship, and not worry about what's going on outside or in here or whatever the case may be. I think it's important that we continually remember this Memorial Day, our veterans, and those who have fought bravely for our country. Amen? Amen. 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 I think it is so vitally important to continually remember that. So thankful for the freedom that we have today to be able to come into the house of the Lord, lift our hands, lift our voices in prayer. Let's exercise that freedom right now and just thank the Lord for all that He's done today. Lord Jesus, I thank You for the freedom we have today. Oh, Jesus, I thank You, Lord. God, I thank You for this country, Lord. I thank You, Lord. God, who for all of those who sacrificed so much, God, You've been so good to us. God, have Your way in this place today. God, lead us, guide us, direct us, Lord, in all things. In Jesus' name, have Your way today. In Jesus' name, God, I thank You for the freedoms of this country. But God, I'm so thankful, God, that we be filled with Your Spirit today. God, I thank You, Lord, when we begin to worship and praise. God, that we have a freedom, Lord, that is found in You. God, we can have a freedom in our heart, freedom from sin, freedom from the ways of this world. Lord, we can look to You, God, the author and the finisher of our faith. God, I thank You, Jesus. Come on, let's lift our hands unto the Lord. He's worthy to be praised in this place. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. I want there to be a spirit of freedom in this place. If you feel like moving out of your aisle today, out of your pew, make your way to the front. If you feel like kneeling in your pew and praying and seeking the face of the Lord, I want you to feel freedom in this place to worship and glorify the Lord, because the Lord is here today. He wants to make a way. He wants to make a difference in your life, and I believe the Lord's going to do it in Jesus' name. Amen? Amen. One more time, let's lift our voices. Let's worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords as the praise team comes. We're going to worship with the Lord Jesus Christ moving in our midst. Hallelujah. God, You are in control. God, with You, Lord, all things are possible. Lord, have Your way today, because where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, lift your voice unto the Lord. God, You're in control today in Jesus' name.
You are God, and You're in control, defeated. for what you've done in my life. You've already done enough, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you,
transform.
we know better is one day, God, in your house. We thank you, Jesus. Oh, I praise you, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, I thank you, Jesus. Oh, I praise you, God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Here we go. Unison.
And better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts. Your house, there is one day in your house.
there's one day in his house, thank you, Lord, than 1,000 outside these walls. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Are you thankful you serve a great God, a great King? Thank you, Jesus. Can we give the Lord a hand clap of praise and just thank him for being here? Praise your name. Praise your name, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I was just thinking about, as Pastor Wade opened up, about Memorial Day and all the veterans out there in the military. And the military does everything they can with excellence. They do their best to do everything with excellence. It doesn't mean the military is perfect, but they do their best. They do it with excellence. And as I was thinking about that, I'm just wondering, when I raise my hands, am I really doing it as unto the Lord, or just because everybody else is doing it? It's so easy right now. Am I really thinking it, Lord, I'm doing this with everything I have. I just want to give it to you, Lord. When I sing and lift up my voice, am I doing it with the spirit of excellence, or just because I know the words and I can sing a little bit? When I dance, when I shout, am I doing it as unto the Lord in the spirit of excellence? I think today, if we can just all lift our hands together in the mindset of excellence, saying, Lord, this is yours. We're here surrendering our lives to you, Lord Jesus. God, this is yours right now, Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise your name, Lord. God, be in this place, Lord. I give you honor and glory today, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Lord, I need you. Hallelujah. I need you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. This is your house, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, I'd rather be here, Lord, for just a minute, God, than not in your arms. I'd rather be in your house, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. 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 I can't imagine not living with him. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. We were talking in class before you're seated. We were talking in class just about how it's easy for someone to say, well, man, but you've got this restriction in church, and you've got to be there on a Sunday. And I think to myself, it's so wonderful to come and just gather together. Whereas I walk in the doors, I feel the presence of God, because someone was already praying. Someone was already working and creating an environment where when I walk in the doors, I already feel like I can immediately get in contact with God. What an awesome pleasure it is to come and worship together. Amen? That we can worship together. Amen. Amen. Thank you for joining us today. Please make your way back to your seats. If you see a guest with us today, just thank them for being at Grace Episodic Church. Amen. We love having people here just to worship with us, just to join in praise to our King of Kings and our Lord of Lords. I have a couple announcements I'm going to read through. And I'll prepare you now just so you have time. When we do take up offering, there is a basket in the middle that is going to be for a special offering for our pastor's trip. I know him, and I think Brother Lincoln and Brother Art Schnitzer is going to Sierra Leone over in Africa, and we'd like to take an offering for that. So as you prepare that offering, I have a couple announcements. This Friday, youth service is at 7:30 p.m. Amen. This week, we're getting ready for the Clawson High School graduation that will be here on June 5th, which I believe is next Monday, if I'm right, next Monday. We need as many ushers and greeters and just support staff to be available. We use all of the doors of the church are going to be used. The parking lot, we need many people just to support and be available in the parking lot. We need people just showing them where the door is to the balcony. Folks, what an awesome time it is to have over 1,000 people at Grace Apostolic Church from the city of Clawson. I think the mayor said there's 11,000 residents in the city of Clawson, and 10% of them are going to be at Grace Apostolic Church in one day. So as many people that can be available, please come to help out with that. Please see Pastor Wade or Brother Anthony if you're available to get involved with ushers and greeters for that day. On June 11th, Sunday, after service, Luke Morris is having a graduation party. Anybody's available, please join us for the graduation party. And Sister Isabel or Elizabeth, whatever she goes by nowadays, graduation party is Saturday, June 17th at 9:30 and 9:30 to 12:30 at the Auburn Hills Church. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's all stand. We're going to go to Lord in prayer for this offering. And I want the Lord to preach to us. Amen? Amen. Let's go in Lord prayer. Lord, we love you today. Thankful, God, for this church. God, that we can come here, Lord, in the mindset of excellence, Lord, to give to you, Lord, to return our tithe to you, Lord, and give an offering with joy. God, we're asking you, preach to us, Lord. Let us listen in the mindset of excellence, God, that we're listening to your word. God, that we can improve ourselves, Lord, that you can preach to us, give us direction, give us understanding, Lord, and we do all these things in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Let's all march.
Come on, let's put our hands together for the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's love him right now. Thank you, Lord. Praise your wonderful name. We worship you, Lord. We exalt you. Come on, we've come to magnify him today. Hallelujah. We've come to give him the best praise we have today. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Come on, I want this to be an atmosphere of worship. I want this to be an atmosphere of miracle signs and wonders. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to your name. Praise your name, Jesus. Lord, we worship you today. We exalt you and magnify you and love you today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What a wonderful presence that's in this room today. Thank you, praise and worship team. Amen for your praise and your worship, for leading us into praise. It'd be wonderful, though, for a church that can overtake the praise team. That our praise is not dictated on how fast or slow the song is, but that the praise team maybe starts it, but the praise of the people over trumps the praise team. Come on, they're not the all in all to successful service. A successful service is when everybody gets their minds on God and worships God, not by what's being sung, but because your praise, you're just so full of love for God and so love for Jesus Christ that it just comes out of you, that it overtakes what the praise team is doing. Come on, amen. Come on, I'm not here based on what songs is. I'm here because I love Jesus. And my praise ought to dictate that I love Jesus Christ. Amen. For all that he has done. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Wonderful spirit. We'll go right to the word of God. John chapter 3. John chapter 3. To all of our guests, thank you for being here today. We count it an honor that you chose Grace Apostolic Church as a place of worship today. We know there's other churches that you had a pass to get here, and we're hopefully that you've come here and you enjoy what you feel. Good to have Lee here today. This is James' son Lee. Glad that he's here today. Amen. In the house of the Lord. Amen. And all of our guests, as he said already, we're so glad you're here. There's a gift for you in the lobby to say thanks for being here. We are leaving on Wednesday. Please remember us in prayer. We're going to go and have a great time. We're going to go and we're going to install Reverend Art as Bishop Art of Kenema, which we're really excited about that. He's been a great teacher and a leader for that church there, and so we're excited about this for Brother Art. He's never been a pastor, but he's gonna skip one office and just go to the next. He's going to be bishop, which I don't believe that being a pastor, you have to be bishop, or that you can't be a bishop without being a pastor. The Bible talks about what a bishop is and the elders are, and he fulfills all those roles, and we're so glad for that experience. Glad to have my son going with me, being able to enjoy that time with my son as well, and the experience he's going to have coming from Africa and what he sees there. Amen. John chapter 3, this is the story of Jesus speaking to Nicodemus at night. And this is the first portion of chapter 3 of when you read, the first time you read about being born again. And Jesus said that except a man be born of the water and spirit, right? That's the Holy Ghost, right? You receive the gift of the Holy Ghost spirit. Then the water also is behind the screen here. We have a pool of baptism of water that we baptize people, not in the titles Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, but in the name of Jesus. And so when you're born, when you're baptized in Jesus' name in the water and you receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, you're what the Bible calls is born again. That's what Jesus said is being born again. And I'm glad I've been born again. Amen? I'm glad I've been born again. But then I want to just focus on one verse of it's a great discord between Jesus and Nicodemus, but I want to bring out one verse here that Jesus says in verse 8. He says, the wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell when it cometh and whither it goeth. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. The wind blows where it wants to, and you can hear the sound thereof. You can't tell where it's coming, where it's going, but you hear it. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. Everyone that's born of the Spirit, there will be a sound come from them. Amen. Amen. I want to talk to you on the subject, so is everyone that is born of the Spirit. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. If you've been born of the Spirit and you're glad about it, would you just raise your hands one more time? Let's love the Lord, because I want the Spirit of God to blow in this house. Come on, does anybody want the winds of heaven to open up in this place right now? Thank you, Jesus. Lord God, blow in this place, Lord God. Lord, blow over everything, Lord. Blow everything that's alive and dead, God. Lord, we talked about things coming alive. Lord, I pray that if someone's dead in their spirit, Lord, something might transpire. Lord, the winds of the Holy Ghost would move over us one more time. God, let it blow like the day of Pentecost. Lord, we are the apostolic church. We are a church of Pentecost. God, this is Pentecost Sunday. Lord, I pray the Holy Ghost would move and stir. Come on, do you want the Holy Ghost to move? Do you want the winds to blow? Oh, God, here I am, Jesus. Blow on me right now. God, transform me and change me into the image that you want me to be, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. We praise your great name. Amen, amen. Everyone say amen to the reading of the word. You may be seated in the name of the Lord Jesus. Amen. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. I want to talk to you a little bit. I would take my time here. I know we're in a holiday weekend, and so some of you don't have to go to school tomorrow, and some of you may not have to work tomorrow. So I just want to unfold and unpack some things in my spirit that I want to deal with, that I believe the Lord wants to deal with the church about. And talk to you about what I believe is the will of God for his church and what he wants to do in this day among his people. I believe that the end of all that God has is not over. I don't believe that God's done all that he can do and will do in the church. I believe that God's just looking for a church that will be ready for it. God's a gentleman. God's not going to move on church that don't want him there. But I believe that if a church wants God to show up and show us things, and we really believe that God will do great things in our day. Oftentimes what we do when we're not maybe so much praying for God's direction, sometimes we get our eyes on what other congregations are doing, and we'll look at what other organizations are rolling out as far as programs go. What is the latest program? We've done that here. We've done block parties. We've done, have people come through and get us all excited about things that are new and trendy in the churches, and rolling out programs. And we notice that when other churches do certain things, that there is a minimal success that happens at church. And so we hear about what they're doing, and so we may call over there and ask that pastor, you want to share me your notes? You know, share me your, what are you guys doing? What's the secret sauce, right? What are you guys doing in your church that's giving everyone so excited? And so they share their notes with us so that we too then can have some type of recognizable success as a church, as far as churches go, so that someone then will call us and ask us to share our notes with them. And how, you know what I'm saying? Churches begin to borrow from each other. You know, people, they borrow best practices. And what are you guys doing that's really causing your church to grow? Now, I understand this because, as you know, I serve as the Missions America director for the Assemblies of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so what do? We put together conferences together, right? We have people come from all different states, and we gather men together and teach us and share with us content on how to build a team to see success for a church. We talk about how to influence guests to get them to come back and enjoy what they feel, and how to prepare a church, and how to get things in order so that when guests come in, the church can be the best that it is, and we certainly want that. And we write down these notes, and we take down these lessons, and we say, "Oh man, that's good. That's good stuff. You know, I'm going to do that." We got to cut our grass at church to make sure, we can't have long weeds hanging out. Man, that's good stuff. I'm going to write that down. When I go home, I'm going to cut the grass at the church. You know, we have all these ideas that we gather from other people talking about the best practices to reach the lost, and I'm going to have to try those new things, and those are great things. And our youth group may go down to National Youth Convention. They may go to a session and talk about how to institute something in your church to better reach the kids in your school and all those good things. And some of our kids may come back and they may want to come down and institute that in our church, at Grace Apostolic Church. And of course that's all fine and well. There's nothing wrong with us borrowing ideas and instituting things in our church and hone our skills when it comes to being a church prepared to reach the lost. I think it's great that you have updates and things like that, and that's wonderful. That's all fine and well, as long as we understand that nothing that we ever learn from each other is as important as having a genuine move of God for ourselves. You cannot create a move of God through man's ingenuity. You can't go to enough conferences or reading enough books to get the presence and power of God to show up. It will not ever happen by men's thoughts or theories or philosophies. But the only way that you'll have a genuine move of God is simply by being connected to the source of it all, by getting on your knees and crying out and saying, God, we must have a move of your Spirit. Jesus in Matthew chapter 11, verse 15, after speaking about John the Baptist and all that he was, said to those around him, he that hath an ear, let him hear. In Mark chapter 4, 3 and 9, Jesus gives us the parable of the sower and the seed. And in verse number 9, after he gave the illustration of what he's trying to show, he says, yet again, he that hath ears to hear, let him hear. Verse 23, speaking of a candle, not to put it under a bushel, Jesus yet again said, if any man have ears to hear, let him hear. 8 more times. In the book of Revelations, Jesus says, he that hath ears to hear, let him hear. Can I tell you today, the will of God for his church is not for us to keep up with whatever everyone else is doing. The will of God is not about us following after the pattern of what other churches are doing, but he is calling us to a place where we have positioned ourselves with humility and with prayer and with fasting and with consecration to have our ears open to hear what Jesus is saying to the church. That is the will of God. Let us not be moved by every trend that blows our way and every fad that comes to the Christian ranks, but let us respond to the leading of the Holy Ghost and Grace Apostolic Church. He that has ears, let him hear what God is saying to the church. Get your ears open. God wants to talk to us, but we've got to have ears to hear. We've got to have ears to hear. Let us get some direction because we're listening for the voice of God, not because we're reading a book from some big name author or some charismatic. We get our, what are we doing looking for charismatic authors? We got an apostolic author right here, Brother Ward, that's speaking things of the Spirit. Listen, don't get direction from a mega church, someone that doesn't even have what you have, but get yourself in a corner somewhere. Get down on a floor. Get somewhere. It might be old-fashioned, but prayer still works. It might be old-fashioned, but God wants to speak to the church. See, after Jesus told his parables, after he spoke things, he said, those, they don't know what I'm talking about, but you guys know what I'm saying. You know what's being said. Some things are dark to you. You can't understand it. You don't know what it's saying. But then Jesus said something remarkable in Mark chapter 4, verse 22. This is what Jesus said. He said, there is nothing hid which shall not be manifested. Neither was anything kept secret, but it should come abroad. There's nothing that I say that I want my church to be groping after and not knowing what I want them to hear. He's saying, I want it to be manifested. I want the church to know when everybody else says it's a secret. God says, no, it's not meant to be a secret, but everything spoken in secret, I want it to come abroad. But the only way you can know what I'm saying is you got to have spiritual ears to understand what I'm saying. The will of God, what Jesus is saying, the Lord wants he wants to reveal to the church all of his mind. We are the body. What happens when the body doesn't listen to the mind? The body goes all sorts of different directions. Jesus Christ wants wants the body to know what the head is saying. You can't have one leg going this way, and maybe on ice skates you do, right? One leg goes that way, and then it's for a bad experience, right? But he doesn't want the body going one way. He doesn't want one man saying, well, the Lord's saying this, and the Lord's saying this, and all of a sudden the body's like, well, what do we do? The Lord says, listen, if you would just consecrate yourselves in 2020, if you get a hold of me and not let go, I promise you, I will reveal to you in this wayward generation. Just because the world's upside down doesn't mean the church has got to grope in the darkness, but rather the church is steady. The church is right on. The church is faithful. And the church hears the voice of God. He doesn't want us to navigate blindly. He doesn't want us to guess in which direction we ought to go as a church. Lord, help us as the world gets worse. They don't want to come into a church and pass by God. I don't know, man. I'm as scared as you are. I'm as nervous as you. Man, dude, listen, man, politics doesn't scare me. The news doesn't scare me. Some people are so, man, your day is good or bad based on what so-and-so says about where we are. Man, the church should be blind to those things, but open to what Jesus Christ is doing. Because every bad thing that happens only caused the church to become a beacon of hope and brighter and brighter and brighter as the world gets worse. So instead of us being worried, instead of us looking at what the newscasts are saying, man, we put our hands together and say, man, people are going to be coming in the church pretty soon. It ain't got that bad yet, but man, I'm going to keep my hands. Man, I can't wait to see what comes in our doors. Why? Because people are looking for something real. People are looking for the wind to blow. People are looking for the Holy Ghost power. Hey, listen, you can't change by yourself. You need the Holy Ghost to blow in your life. I want the fire to fall. I want the wind to blow. I want God to do something that God wants to do in his church. In his church. Man, this world is absolutely nuts. We've got war on the east of us. We're living in a country full of perversion. We're living in a country where our children are targets by deviant minds. Let me tell you something, folks. This is not a time for the church to happily float down a river of ease and hope to end up in some sunny bank somewhere, wherever the current should take us. But I'm telling you, the church has got to be intentional. There must be a voice of God. There must be people not satisfied. I've got to see more. I've got to experience more of God's glory, not less of God's glory. Come on, am I starting to siphon something in you? Am I starting to grow something in you? Is there something inside you that says, oh God, let the wind blow. Oh God, let your power fall. Isaiah 30:21. Isaiah said, in thine ears shall hear a word behind thee, saying, this is the way, walk ye in it. Let me tell you something. We don't just want any way. We want the way. We want God's way. We want the voice of God. We want the wind of God to blow on the church so we know what we should be doing as a church in this hour. Only a church that is truly led by the Spirit will make the impact that's needed to be made in these uncertain times. I want to say it's so good to have the whole Hubarth family here with us today. So Jesus deals with the Spirit when speaking to Nicodemus in John chapter 3. Now, if you know, you read the Bible, you know the Spirit is likened in many different things, right? The Spirit is objectified in many different ways. We know that water is symbolic to the Spirit. The water flows like the Spirit. And we know it's also fire. Fire falls. It's the Spirit. And we know that it was even in the bodily form of a dove, right? So all these symbols are the makeup of the Spirit. But Jesus himself likened it to the wind. Jesus said, you can't tell where it comes from or where it goes, but you can hear the sound of the wind. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. Now, Jesus is telling us that when someone receives the precious gift of the Holy Ghost, you won't see the spiritual manifestation happening at that moment. You're not only going to see blue rays of light come down from heaven on their head, say, I see the blue light. It's like Christmas, like Kmart discount. Some of you wouldn't know that. The blue lights go run there. It's not like blue lights shine on our head. There's no visible manifestations. But you will hear the sound of it. Of course, we know that this is the sound of someone speaking in other tongues. When you receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, you will speak with other tongues. In Acts chapter 10, the Jews that were with Peter saw that the Gentiles had received the Holy Ghost. How do we know this? Verse 46 says, for they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. The Holy Ghost infilling is not some sort of ambiguous spiritual encounter. It's not just some sort of walking into, oh, I feel much better now. I feel like I'm new. No, it's not just some ambiguous thing that you think maybe you had it 10 years ago, but rather it is an experience that once you receive it, you know the day, you know the moment, you know the place you were, because you'll never be the same after you receive the Holy Ghost. And the good news about this Holy Ghost experience that I'm preaching to you on Pentecost Sunday is that this gift did not die with the disciples. But Peter said in Acts 2:39, for this promise is unto you and your children, to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. Can I tell you, the wind is still blowing today. The power of God is as powerful as it's ever been. And I want Grace Apostolic Church to say, oh God, blow on us. Blow on us, God, blow. Let the Holy Ghost fire. Let the wind fall on us, Lord. Blow in our atmosphere. We don't know how the wind blows. You know, you try to talk to the meteorologist and say, okay, so how does the wind blow? Well, it blows this way or this way. I said, well, where does it start? You can't tell where the wind starts. There's not like a starting point, end point. It stops at this end of the road and turns back around. It's a mystery. No one knows how it works. No, it's only God, the creator of all things, can tell you how it works. No one can know that. But we know it's of God. And can I tell you, the Lord wants to be so in tune with his Spirit that we don't have to explain everything that God does. But we know when we see it, that's God. The problem with the church is we want to have everything explained to us. explain to me how miracles work. Explain to me how this is going to happen. How am I going to? And we want someone to give us written word on how everything happens. Let me tell you something. There's some things God just reveals for himself. And he just wants the church to understand, listen, I can't know everything that God's doing, but I trust when God begins to move, things begin to happen. And when things begin to happen, we will give God glory for it. That's why it's the wind. We don't know how it works. We don't know where it comes and goes. We don't know those things. We don't know how this all works and where it ends. But we hear the sound of it. There is a response in nature because of it. Nature responds to the winds of God. I don't know if you've ever been out in the woods early in the morning or late at night and the winds blow and those old trees begin to creak a little bit. Man, it's kind of... put the hair on the back of your neck, stand up a little bit. Just these creaking of these wind, you can't see anything. All you can hear is the wind blowing. All these trees around, so big all around, start creaking the wind. They begin to make these noises. The wind blows back and forth. And you know, not just outside in the woods. You can be in the house and know that the wind is blowing. How? Because the trees are moving. Nature is responding. The things that God created in the earth all had to respond to the moving of the wind. The only things I can think of to look outside that wouldn't be moving are dead things. I'd be a bit scared if every time we had a strong wind, my garage would kind of just move a little bit. Or my Jeep just starts to go. Every time. Now, those things don't move. Those are unmoved by the wind. Why? Because those are dead things. But you get anything that's planted in the ground, you get anything that has life at all, and when the wind of the Creator moves on them, they have to just automatically move as the wind goes through. The Bible says when his word goes forth, it will not return void. But the Bible says that the hills and the mountains will break forth with songs and the trees will clap their hands. Can I tell you, if nature itself knows how to respond to the presence of God, is there anybody that's got any life that can respond to the presence of the wind of God? Come on, you better check your pulse. The Holy Ghost wind is blowing, and I want him to blow on me. I want him to change me. I want him to touch me today. It's an automatic response. You just do it because the power of the Holy Ghost. You just respond to what you feel. I believe that with what God is doing, God is going to prepare a Grace Apostolic Church to realize what we have here is not going to be enough. Because when nature responds, when the wind blows so much, there's absolute carnage in the way. Things happen so great that you can't believe it. Things start to move when the wind blows. Sometimes the wind is so powerful, it will literally push over massive trees. Trees you thought, man, there's no way that thing could ever be moved. And the wind comes and it just pushes it over. Because the wind is so powerful. Sister Dana and I went to California to do a church growth deal out there. And while we were there, we had the privilege to take some time off and go see the sequoias up in the mountains there in California. Man, it just, Brother Jeff, unbelievable. The sequoias, I mean, fire can't kill those things. Man, you see the worst fires and those sequoias, they say those sequoias get stronger. They build a shell around. I mean, you see black all around there. Not even the fire can destroy, but man, every once in a while, you come across this long 200-foot, you'd love it, 300 feet, huge. I'm talking General Sherman is 35 feet across. 35 is one tree. And every once in a while, you get out there and you see something falling there. It's a long old log out there. It's a big old sequoia that had succumbed to the power of the wind. The roots are up, and it's just a powerful thing that you thought could never be moved. But when the Creator blows on that thing, that unrelenting power of the wind says, "Hey, I know you're big, but the wind is more powerful than that." And if we can see that in the physical, and the Lord likened the Holy Ghost to the wind, can I tell you, if you would open up your life and let the Holy Ghost blow on you, there's some things you thought were so big. There's some sequoia-type problems that you've got in your life. But I'm telling you, the Holy Ghost can blow those things over. The Holy Ghost can do new things. The Holy Ghost can change you. Come on, but you gotta let the wind blow. You gotta let the wind blow. I wanna tell you, it's more than just a noise. It's more than a sound. The wind can disrupt everything around you. It can bring alcoholics in and cure them of alcoholism. It can take the drug addict out of his funk and make him a saint. It can take young people that are saying, "God, use me," that can stir a revival in their school. I'm talking about a genuine outpouring of God's Spirit. I wonder, does anybody say, "Lord, if it's for me, God, I want that Holy Ghost pop." Cannot be contained in one place. Grace Apostolic Church is not going to be big enough. We are the book of Acts Church. In Acts chapter 2, the Bible says, "In the upper room, there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting." Everybody in that house received the Holy Ghost. When the Holy Ghost moves through, there shouldn't be some saying, "Man, I got it so good." And others say, "I didn't get anything." There's something wrong. If you want to know how God wants to move, He wants to move from left to right, back and front. He wants a whole place filled with His Spirit. If there's anybody that doesn't have the Holy Ghost today, guess what? Today's your day. We're in Pentecost Sunday. There is a power in this house. There is a wind that's blowing. Today's the day to receive the Holy Ghost. Come on, do we still believe that God's filling people with the Holy Ghost? Do we still believe that God can heal diseases? Do we believe that the power of God still wants to move and do miracles in our midst? It filled all the house we were sitting, and that was not the end of the story. Filled the house, they all left, they went and had dinner afterwards. It was a great service. No. Verse number 6, I believe it's 6. It says, "And when this was noised abroad," it started in a little upper room, and it was so exciting that someone said, "I can't keep it here." And they opened up a door, and that same spirit, those people so excited in the upper room, began to move into the streets where all those foreigners were in their city. Can I tell you something? That what we have cannot be contained in a room. It moved into the streets. We cannot put what we have into a box. How often do we do that? Man, it moves in here. and the doors are closed, and we go our own way, and we all had a great day. We were all touched. We were all filled. We were all excited, but it never moved any further beyond that. Can I tell you that the type of wind that I'm talking about cannot be contained in 42,000 square feet called Grace Apostolic Church, but the true power of God wants to fill every neighborhood. God wants to go down every street. God wants to fill every school. The wind blows where it wants to. God wants to blow on all flesh. And I'm just telling you, God's going to blow on people you could never imagine. There's going to be people in this place. I was telling Brother Brad, Reverend Brad, today, you know, when people come in all strung out, all upset, all whatever the world's done, they're simply the byproduct of the environment they've been born into. What kind of environment, if you were to know anything about God and you were to look at the news, you look at our advertisements, what kind of stuff to wear, how to look, what would you naturally think you should be looking like? What? How do you think you would be growing up if you had no knowledge of God? You're simply the byproduct of what this world, who is godless. This world has no sense of holiness or righteousness. What do you think you would do? You simply come up and do what the, because those are what the models wear. That's what Hollywood looks like. So all of a sudden, you simply resemble the atmosphere of where you're born. Oh, but praise God. That's why Jesus said, it doesn't matter how you're born the first time. I want to bring you into a new environment. I want to bring you into righteousness. I want to bring you to holiness. I want to bring you to power. I want to give you a new birth. I want you to be born again. Come on, the wind is blowing. The wind is blowing. God's doing something. God's changing lives. I want the Holy Ghost to fall. I'll be closing here a few moments. The wind blows where it listeth. In other words, the wind of God blows where it wants to go, where it's determined to go. God wants to blow on all flesh. The neighbor you can't stand, the neighbor that's got a better garden than you, the neighbor, you know, whatever it is, the people you can't stand, the race or culture or creed or whatever you don't like, guess what? The Holy Power wants to move on them. Jesus wants to save them. Jesus loves them. We do not own the market on this spirit thing. We as apostolics don't have a right to distribute spirit. It's not like we've realized a secret and we don't want anybody else to know, but oh God, use me as a force. Use me as a channel, God. Use my life, Lord. I don't want to have this a secret in my life. I don't want to have this every day, and the people I work with don't even know I go to church. But every time I open up the, you know, they have these memes, you know, it's like coming, it shows you Monday, you know, and you're all like, you know, then all of a sudden, you know, on Friday, they open the doors and the wind just blows. You're just like, you know, everything's flying around, you know, after month, because Friday, you know, school's out, day, weekend's coming, and the meme is Friday because here the wind's. Guess what? If we were full enough of the Holy Ghost, every time you go to work, every time you go to school, every time you open the doors and there ought to be a wind that radiates to that place. Why? Because you're carrying the wind of the Holy Ghost. You are inundated, empowered, and filled with God's Spirit, and everybody can feel. Everybody can feel the difference. They have to respond to it. They have to respond to what they feel, because in nature, I know they may not be familiar with it, but because God called them and they're living creatures, anytime someone full of the Holy Ghost goes, there's a wind that blows past them. There's something they can't explain. They can't see it. But every time they get around us, they say, man, there's something about them. What kind of impact are you making? What kind of influence are you being? Are people being stirred? Listen, every time Paul went somewhere, they either wanted to stone him or they wanted to cleave to him. Listen, there's going to be some people that are going to hate, absolutely hate what you're doing. They're going to want you out of their school. They're going to want you out of their classroom because they can't stand it, because they themselves are not ready to turn over to a God that's calling them. But I promise you, there's some hungry hearts that's getting ready. God's going to blow on them. And because you've been born of the Spirit, they're going to cleave you and say, hey, I don't understand why you do what you do, but there is a difference in you, and I've got to have. Let the Spirit blow, God. Let the Spirit blow. Come on, let the Spirit blow, God. Blow on us. Give us a hunger. Give us a desire, Lord. Oh, let the Holy Ghost fall on us, Lord Jesus. Let the Holy Ghost blow. Listen, I don't care what you've been through. I don't care what your life record history says. I'm telling you, when the Holy Ghost moves, he can absolutely blow things out of your life, that he can make room for himself and do something new in your life. Doesn't matter what your record is. Man, I want to tell you, Brother Chester and Brother Wilkes went down to a prisoners conference this weekend, and I got some pictures here. Would you share us a picture of what happened down in Mississippi, this weekend? Go back. That guy right there was a leading gang member of that prison, baptized in Jesus' name. Yeah. Give us another picture. Give us a black and white, loving each other. Come on, don't, come on. The Holy Ghost transcends color and culture and creed. Give us another picture here. Man's going down, Brother Wilkes. Can't believe they let Brother Wilkes baptize him, but I guess it's good enough. So let's go. We got Brother Wilkes there. Comes out of the water. There is a freedom, folks. There is a deliverance in the name of Jesus. I don't care what you're bound by. I don't care what's got you entangled. I'm telling you, there is a freedom in the Holy Ghost. There is a power of God that's blowing on this generation. This weekend, I make this statistic everywhere I go. In America, there's over 2 million incarcerated people behind bars in the land of the free, in the home of the brave, over 2 million. Do you know America houses more prisoners than any other country in the world? In the world, no other country has more prisoners behind bars than America does. But this weekend, just this weekend, 59 prisoners were baptized in Jesus' name. 7 received the gift of the Holy Ghost. 35 were refilled with the gift of the Holy Ghost. In the last 7 months, 148 prisoners were baptized in the lovely name of Jesus Christ. I say, God, let the wind of your power blow. God, give America revival. Yes. Yes. Oh, God, Lord, let the wind blow over our backslidden sons and daughters, God. Let the wind blow over people that had hot, red-hot experiences around the altar, but somehow they grew callous and cold, and now they're indifferent out there somewhere doing whatever the world wants them to do. I'm telling you, the Lord loves those people. Oh, God, let the wind blow on those people, God. Let our doors be ready to open up to prodigal sons and daughters that may have been away for a while, but they come back. And when they come back, they don't want fake. They don't want watered down. They want the real, genuine power of the Holy Ghost. Oh, God, let the wind of your Spirit blow on the Catholics, God. There's no greater force for unborn babies being killed than the Catholic Church. There's no greater people, there's no greater force in our country, in our world right now than the Catholic Church every day trying to fight against this gruesome attack on the most innocent Americans that we know of, our babies. And the Catholic Church is doing a good thing, but oh God, you get those people full of your Spirit. You let those dead Catholic churches begin to ring out the Holy Ghost and they begin to speak in tongues. I'm telling you, talk about revival. because the Spirit blows where it wants. Do you think the Spirit wants to blow in the Catholic churches? Oh, you better believe it does. We've got four precious girls, man. Four precious girls come to this church on a regular basis. They have to pick and choose what service they get to go to. Can you imagine that? Could you imagine having to pick and choose as a teenager? What, you can't go to too many services. You can only go to this one or that one. Three little girls from the Lutheran school that my daughter goes to school with, man. They came to church. This is their first experience. They never experienced it before. But, man, when they put their hands up, their feelers up there, they felt that wind blow. And, man, it absolutely changed their life. And all three of those precious girls, I would adopt all three if I could. Those three precious girls have all received the gift of the Holy Ghost. They would be baptized, but their parents said, you can't be baptized. You were baptized Lutheran, and that's all you're ever going to be. And I say, God, do you think God wants to blow on the Lutheran church? Do you think God wants to see revival in Lutheran High Northwest? Do you think God wants to bring families in that have never experienced what we have? I promise you the Holy Ghost is going to start to blow, but the people of God have got to pray, Lord, send your Spirit. Send your Spirit, God, blow on our way. But we can't expect it to excite them if we've grown just indifferent. It's just you were used to this. Another spirit, another service, another sermon. I'm telling you, there ought to be something that refreshes over us. Oh, God, I just want to say blow over me again one more time. They're getting ready to sing something. But I wonder if we could just raise our hands and make this place an altar. Make this place an altar. Raise your hands and begin to let the Holy Ghost presence blow over you again. Come on, come on, come on. Come on, he wants to blow in your life again. He wants to blow of your situation. Oh, let the Holy Ghost wind blow on us, oh God. Blow those things over in my life that are so big. Lord, bring me to a fresh relationship with you.